Over 1 million cinema lovers have already subscribed to Film Companion. What are you waiting for? Hit the bell icon and join our film family. Doing a producers roundtable after 2 years.
Yay!
And I'm so excited to have all of you here. Thank you. Thank you for making the time.
Thank you.
You know the famous nobody knows anything, William Goldman's diktat about showbiz, right? I feel like through this pandemic, and we're not through it yet, that has really become the truth. Really, genuinely, nobody knows anything. All bets are off. And we have gathered here to still make some sense of the present and try and a little bit tell the future. So, if you can, tell me in one word what the last 18 months have been like for you. Zoya?
Insightful.
Nice.
Chaos.
Traumatizing.
Hard work.
Complicated.
Yeah, that about sums it up. But my sense is that at least in this year, I feel like Hindi cinema has really languished. You know, I see what Malayalam cinema has done in terms of storytelling. I see the kind of box office Tamil and Telugu cinema has managed through a pandemic with films like Master or Jati Ratnalu. And we haven't had even a little of that. Why do you all think that is? What has happened?
I mean, could it have something to do with Maharashtra having a pretty strict lockdown?
But the quality of the films.
Ah, you mean in terms of that?
Just the storytelling.
So the bizarre thing that I don't think was planned because of the pandemic was genuinely the quality of certain films that we saw that, you know, perhaps went straight to OTT or that released with very limited audiences, theatrically. Sometimes I feel, and I'm saying this with a lot of seriousness and no jest, that perhaps Indian cinema really got saved and salvaged for this year 2020 and half of 2021, because there were certain films that were just not up to speed. You know, they were just not up to the mark, and they were bigger films. They were with massive motion picture movie stars. They had to go to digital because of, you know, various reasons. I think one was the quality suddenly took, and it's not that 2019 was that bad a year.
Yeah.
You know, we had some really good pieces of Hindi cinema. 2020 began with Tanaji and had Thappad, you know, which actually began with a lot of promise. And then the pandemic hit us in March, and subsequently every film that really was direct to OTT or didn't make it at all wasn't really up to mark. That's one, is the quality suddenly suffered. And I'm of the belief that in this digital era, where writing is of such prominence, because the digital era is predominantly writers, you know, it's a writer's medium. And I believe that those writers are doing better work in cinema as well. I think some of them, the concept of commercial, the concept of what we know as mass, commercial, mainstream, that has been evolving. And I think drastically changing, and I think much faster than we're accounting for. And we have to reinvent that space. Because when we say, oh, it's a masala film, or it's a mass film, or it's a, you know, we'll just do it because apparently there is a mass section that will love it, I think we're second guessing people who actually have moved on.
Yeah.
And they've moved on, and some of us are still stuck there. We still believe that this item song will help that opening. We still believe that that movie star presence will actually override a screenplay loophole. We're still believing a lot of all this rubbish.
There's also a collective consciousness. You know what I mean? There's also a sense of, as what he said, when you make something, and the films you're, I think, referring to are personal stories. They are way more personal than the let's make a mass movie for the mass. And you have to have conviction to tell those stories and to understand that someone will relate to it, you know. And those are not happening. And it's when I say collective consciousness, it's like one film, when it does well, it spurs another filmmaker's idea and another filmmaker's faith and another filmmaker. So there is, I mean, all indie cinema or anything, all of them came in waves. You know, they came in periods for a reason. And also that collective involves the audience. So I think that somewhere got dissipated. We had it. Mm. It was happening. And I think the pandemic came and then everything again went back to, you know, let's hold on to the big stuff. Let's not make this. Let's not take a risk on that. And I think it'll come back. I think because the palette has changed and people want to do stuff that they believe in.
So let's talk about this idea that the palette has changed. Okay, I of course, this is the big question, right? What are they going to come back into theaters for? And I saw this piece on Box Office India that said that perhaps Chandigarh Kare Aashiqui has underperformed because these kind of multiplex films are now streaming films. Do you all think that's true? I mean, are these sort of mid-budget, high-concept films that we all championed as content cinema, are these now going to be straight to streaming? Is that the new world?
I mean, if it works for the producer, then yes. But you can't interchange these experiences. People have written off cinema since TV.
Sure.
TV came, they were like, no one will go to the theater. Then video came, they were like, no one will go to the theater. Then home theater systems came, they were like, now why should we go to the cinema? The thing is, these are not experiences that can be changed.
Correct. But what are they going to come to watch? What will they pay that ticket for? Is what the question is, right?
I suppose, you know, the thing is that, as you said, what will they pay for is that you have to buy a ticket when you go to a theater. That's actually what defines stardom. That's what defines elastic profit. You know, that act of having a smash hit.
Yeah.
Now, obviously, because the streamers have come along and because everyone was locked up in their homes, so you got default compulsory viewing. And by that logic, you got to see a lot of stuff. Mm. And that's what happened to the audience. So the palette changing has essentially been forced. It's been forced upon a billion people and it got changed in that sense. So now coming back to theatres will obviously require them to be able to pay money for it. They would want to do that. They should want to do it. They should see value for money in it. So obviously that's where big stars come up, you know, that the big movie is still the draw because then you're still going to see that. So I think the smaller ones or what we call high concept or this famous, you know, the multiplex film will come under increasing pressure for screens. It'll come under increasing pressure for actually getting crowds to come in and see it. Because a lot, anyway, with the window breaking down, the assumption is that this is going to show up on TV or streamer in any case, right? So if I've got to pay $200 or $300 today, I can wait a month.
But it's
there's
sad.
No urgency,
I mean,
to go and do it.
That breaks my heart,
But that's just the way it's evolving.
It is
globally,
what it
it's
is.
Evolving.
It's. I think that the old quality, a film like Shershah would have, people have gone to the theaters. They would have gone. They would have, whether it came on Amazon and it's done fantastically on Amazon, but people would have gone. It has Siddharth, it has war, it has nationalism,
music with
it has great music, it has a superb love story, it has everything. They would have gone. So quality. I mean, one of the people responsible for in this, I mean, we've had to reduce as a company, we've had to release films. Because, like she said, as a producer, we have to release films. There are other things that we have to deal with, actors. So we have had to release films. We know very well that maybe the film should have waited. We should have waited for the film to come to the theaters. But we had to release that film or whatever.
But you're saying with quality, they will come into theaters.
I think so.
No, but I'll tell you one thing, Anu. When it comes to multiplex films, and you know, we sectionalize them, and call them multiplex films for whatever reason.
Sort of narrow casted films.
Like, let's take an account of all the multiplex films that did well in the past, pre-pandemic. Gully Boy, there's of course been films like Neerja or Kapoor and Sons, and there have been like Pink, and a lot of these films fall into that slot. You know, in fact, some of Ayushman films have been beyond multiplex films because they've been more commercial, like Bala.
Yeah.
Bala is a much more accessible
Girl.
Film. Dream Girl.
Yeah.
They're more commercial. You can't just call, you know, all his films multiplex films. He's done some massive mainstream movies that have done the numbers. But I'm purely talking very urban, rooted to this urban terrain, which would be a Kapoor and Sons or a Neerja, a Gully Boy, for example. I think that what you have to monitor your expectation for is the Friday. Because that is any case had changed. The Friday number anyways had started changing much before even the pandemic. What we knew of an opening, films had stopped taking an opening unless it was completely youth centric. Films that college kids would go to see was opening morning shows, because that's the way it's been since time immemorial. Youth opens your morning shows. And then it used to flatline through the day, and then probably not when the families didn't come, and if it was just youth-centric, it would close at an average day. The Saturday jump would come if the content was loved, appreciated, applauded, reviewed, all that. You saw sometimes an 80%, 70% jump on a Saturday. And then the Sunday cements your Saturday, and your Monday sometimes is very close to your Friday. So what you have to do is monitor your expectation of Friday. Not every multiplex film is going to open to a thunderous number. But if it's liked and loved, there is no way, and I believe no pandemic, absolutely no external force that can stop a good film from having a theatrical viewing. We released Shershah because of the climate that we were in. There was a lot at stake. It was a very expensive film. We had waited on it for over a year and a half. I had to take that call. But I know it would have done the theatrical number because I've actually seen the love the film received across the board. It's changed the game for everyone in the film. But I'm still rooting for the films that you are lamenting today and saying that have we lost them forever? No, we haven't. But if the film doesn't work, we can't just say it didn't work because of the pandemic. Something has to be radically wrong with the film. Sure. That's why it didn't do a number. Because if a film is loved, it's going to find an audience. Yes, it'll be staggered. Right. Yes, it'll come in on Saturday, it'll stay on Monday, it'll stay on the second Friday. Let's not monitor our way of assessing the film for the Friday. The second thing, what I think all middle order movies have to do is research. You have to do market research. Because if you want to take the theatrical leap, then you have to get data, which is something no one does.
Data to do what?
There's Yuva right now that is watching films. There's Ormax that I've had a supremely successful run with in terms of how they do their city-based research. I've changed movie scripts. I've changed plot points, all because all the successful films we've had have very ironically been all Ormax researched films.
Really?
We do that also.
And I know they do it. We have two ways of doing it. An organic way, which is friends and family, and call people who I don't know, call people who you don't know. And you know, we've been doing that, Nikhil knows, we've been doing that even when of the year in my K era.
Yeah, it should be done very informally earlier.
Correct.
Right?
Correct. In the sense. Correct.
When I'm reading, it's a docket that Ormax sends you and they give you a score. Like, for example, and I can be very candid and honest, when we get Bhoot for Ormax, because I don't get horror films. I don't understand them because I don't watch them. I'm too scared. I realized when I got the Ormax research that, oh, this is a problem. It was a low score. Then we tried to alter it. We went a little high, but we knew that this is where the film would land. I was very ready. Similarly, with Good News, we got a Shesha. Even Shesha, though it was not a theatrical, we got some amazing feedback in any case, and the points we made help. So I think all middle order movie films,
but also platforms do it.
Must put to research. Any filmmaker who says I'm not sharing my film 9 out of 10 times, they have no right to say it because they haven't put 1 rupee into that movie.
Yeah.
The wonderful Rishi Kapoor. Rishi Kapoor should tell me every time, why do you all believe as if you all are making an atom bomb? Yaar, duniya ko dikhao. Mr. Raj Kapoor would show would call the staff, would call the pews, would call the watchmen, he would say, make them sit down and they would watch together and he would take down notes.
I would go as far as saying it, show it to a hard-nailed critic. Show it to an absolutely like an audience who you would know would diss this content. It's not his or her genre. Show it to everyone. Take what you need to. I'm not saying you start listening to everybody, you'll go mad. But you have to know, you have to come prepared. Then that Friday will not give you that shock.
Yeah.
You know, because you're like, something will be wrong in your trailer. Put your trailer to test. Put your poster to test. Test it all. Yeah. Sometimes we believe we have a kick-ass trailer, but only we are believing this.
Yeah.
In our own homes, in our offices, because mummy told us, and my friend told us, and we showed our drivers the trailer.
And now, Karan, we have that 500 bubble of Twitter, right? Social media, that we are feeling. All my
I never know my Twitter. Time at research screening, she showed it to a hard-nailed exhibitor who told her there's too many driving shots in Zindagi Na Mili Ki Dobara.
They're just driving. I'm like, it's a road movie. That's
my criticism.
Then he said, too much rap in Gully Boy. And she's like, it's a film about rappers.
Yeah. I want to meet this man.
Oh, we don't want to tell him. But if he's watching this, he knows.
This music. I'm like, okay. And so you can't take everything seriously.
Correct.
But you can, of course.
You get away. And you know what's interesting is you have different screenings.
Yeah.
And you know that, okay, in this screening, 2% of the people said this or 1% of the person said that. Ignore. 20% said this. Then 10-15% felt the same way. Then 30% of this felt, you know, you have a problem.
Correct.
So when it's across the board, the point keeps coming up, you know it's a problem area, it's not connecting. Then sometimes you're like, should I edit this out? And across the board, that happened with me in Zindagi. We wanted to cut the film. And we were like, should we cut out I'm a Rock Chick? You know, because that was not really related to the narrative, but it was an insight into a character like Kalki. Otherwise, she would have just been a caricature, you know?
Yeah.
And but it could have gone and not affected the story. And I asked everyone, should that be? It was not one person said yes. It was like a resounding no, I love it.
Right.
So you know that, keep
Correct.
It in. So
Correct.
There's I find it very helpful.
I'm very skeptical of anybody who praises the film. So I start from zero. So I'm the worst.
Tumhe kyun pasand hai?
They come and they say it's too good. No, it can't be.
But it's not.
It's not possible. It's not. So I start suspecting that person and I get very personal. So I start from there. You know, so and this whole the editing room hill raha tha, log itne hans rahe the. How is it possible? Are these superlatives really are very? It's very difficult to. It's terrible.
It is true.
Hill raha tha.
But I don't meet these hilarious audiences. I
keep a list and then I show that director saying that all these people who told you it was great, but they never talked to me.
I'm sorry, but we don't have parents who are just us.
Hiru is not telling me one good thing about any movie.
Yeah,
her mom
scary.
Told her to cut the diving, the skydiving in Zindagi Na Mili
Ki Dobara. She's like, you have to cut it down. You're boring me now. Because it was much longer. It was gorgeous. Yeah.
My mother is hysterical. Yeah. She's like, why are they talking so much in this movie? So I said, but it's a conversational film. You know, they're going to talk. Why can't you make films like Ye Jawani Hai Deewani? I said, that is how she said. Then when she saw Dil Dhadakne Do, she was like, see, make movies like this. I mean, like, anything violent and all that, she's like, this is not going to be. She's just not a fan. I don't know what to do about her.
So it's not like we can say that.
Mommy liked it. But listen, the other thing, speaking of OMAX and research, so the numbers that have been given to me, I spoke to Nitin Teja Hooja, who's the CEO at the Producers Guild.
Yes.
2020, there was 80% loss of revenue. Harminder Sandhu at Box Office India said 21. We should have looked ideally at net of 8,500 crores. We're going to look at 1,500 crores. Okay, that's pretty grim. I understand that producers have made money because there are streaming platforms, but distributors, exhibitors obviously haven't. Given this scenario, apparently, actor prices are still going up. Salaries are still going up.
Oh, I have so much to say about this.
But what is happening?
Every year on your producers' roundtable, I say the same thing.
But how is this possible?
I am so fed up.
But Karan, how is it possible?
I want to tell you, I have seen actors' price rise through the worst period of cinema. For no reason. There was an X amount. 3 months later, it is here. 3 months later, but why? They have not had a release. And their last release was a failure. Their films have not taken off. And yet they are just going on because they are riding on the digital money. Their managements or whatever tell them that digital itna de raha hai, paisa itna music se aa raha hai. Your recovery is this. But who is making these charts? Who are doing all this? They've gone beyond diluted, I want to tell you. Like, and we all have to just suck it up and work with them because this is what we do.
Or not work with them.
What will we do?
Really?
Wow. work with other people. People will not stop watching
movies. There are all of those movies. There are verticals involved. There is a satellite, there is a digital, there is music. These are your three verticals that you sell. When you do your mathematics and you take certain actors, you have certain recoveries, you can make your stories. The moment you go completely raw and new, you have to cut on the quality, cut on the way you make the film. Unless you're a big filmmaker like yourself.
No, but
so
some
can
narratives you can. But the thing is also the disparity of the above the line and below the line, I find it offensive.
It's ridiculous.
Your technical crew, it's offensive. You cannot make a good film without technicians. They are artists. They're not just technical crew. And the disparity is just.
Pay the writer. Pay the writer. Pay the cinematographer. Pay the editor.
I think that you like people have to collectively decide, and that's
what I'm saying. You all are the biggest filmmakers currently working. How would you not be able to do this together?
It's not possible.
Come on.
You can't do it.
No, why lie?
No, I agree. It's never going to happen together.
It's not possible.
What Karan is saying is there always be that one film where you can't cut the budget.
You can't go with the film. You are so dependent on that filmmaker.
You know what? We have to start with
who has sat writing that script for 2 years. Once his or her film greenlit, then an actor says yes. Then you know that for that filmmaker, you have to stretch because that bichara filmmaker has been working. So you will pay that money knowing that recovery may ho jayega, but it's not fair because you make nothing. You worked.
No,
your
but what about like working structures with back ends and stuff?
They are not understanding these back end structures because in the climate that we're in, nobody's taking theatrical back ends. Then you're taking percentage of profit, you know, which also you can offer. See, there are mega stars that you strike those deals with. They make sense. What I'm not understanding is that there is a younger order that have yet to really prove their muscle at the box office. You know, they can immediately, you'll hear 25, 30, 35. I'm like, what are these numbers?
These are crores.
Yes, obviously.
But can people stop talking multiples of 9?
Yeah.
It just goes up by 9 times. How?
And 9
is my lucky number.
And then you want to show that report card to them. This is, hello, uncle. This is what you open to. This is what your film did. But no.
But wait. You're telling me, and Sameer, you're saying that this conversation, this hello uncle, this is what your film opened to, cannot be had?
No, it is being had. And as you said, that there are some people you take, some people you have to take. You cut deals that work out in that manner. And then many things now you've got to make hard calls and move on. So, I mean, in the series business, what's happening, and increasingly it'll happen in films, because the same thing is going to happen, is that there's a new breed of actor that'll come up. There will be, a lot of the middle order. Again, as I'm saying, who's A-list is A-list.
Yeah.
Who has the draw, who arrives with that package, then arrives with that package. And there's something to be said for that. A lot of the newcomers is a different world. You're telling a great story, you're doing all of that. The middle order is always what gets killed, That's the flab, right? That's the one that is, doesn't deserve it, shouldn't get it, it's delusional, all of that. And that will come under fire, and it is happening already.
Is that happening?
I think it's happening. I mean, I think in the...
Nikhil is looking very skeptical.
What is happening?
That the middle order is sort of having this conversation of you don't deserve this money.
I don't know who these people are in the middle, but I have certainly not had any such conversations with them.
No, that's what's good. You should not have the conversation.
In terms of, I would like to have many conversations with many people, but I just, it's just...
You seriously saying dharma cannot tell people that this is too much?
You can have hard conversations. Probably you can strike a better deal than maybe another production house will, but it's still not fair. It's still not fair, and I'm not saying that I would rather pay top dollar and much more to members of the technical crew who really, really make your film special. There are people who, editors who have saved films. There are cinematographers that have uplifted films.
Yeah.
And I agree with Zoya, I'm like, why am I paying this actor over 15 crores and I'm paying my editor 55 lakhs? It's not making any sense to me. But that's just suddenly become the market norm. And then there are certain editors and cinematographers and now lead technicians that have upped their numbers, and good for them. Good for them, good for writers. More power to them. If they're delivering, they must be paid. I love the way that there are certain people, even in our own production house, I feel the mindset is like, why are we paying the writer so much? But how dare you say that? I mean, the film is good because of the writing. It's not good because an actor's going to come and do their job. Of course, they'll do their job well. But the fulcrum of this film lies in its narrative.
Yeah.
How can you not understand that I'm all about that? All about that.
Nikhil?
Well, I mean, just to paraphrase what Karan is saying, again, I'm not taking any names, but there are only 7-8 people who you have to go and who are actually deciding everything. So when they decide the number, everybody follows, right? So if he's getting that number, as a producer, you know, oh my God, if I'm giving this guy this, this guy's going to find
what
out.
What is that number?
It's reached 135 crores. So I'm not even getting into that.
Sure.
Right. So
it's not 15, but
I won't make that movie.
Exactly. Yeah.
I'm not making this.
Don't
movie.
Make
so
that
135 crores to one actor.
Anu, the thing
no,
is,
no, Nikhil, to one actor.
Yes,
to
one actor. Yes. To one actor. I don't have it.
How
I
have things
it.
Been in LA for you?
There's a lovely line. There's a lovely line. This particular actor told me, "Six hero hai, do jail mein, sab mere paas aayenge." Done. It's over.
Oh man, that's grim.
No, but the thing is that you don't have, if these are the six, and you have to pay them because, you know, they're the ones who get that draw, right? And
sure,
you have to do
okay.
it. But there are others to work with, and it doesn't, this thing about if X gets this number and that benchmarks the industry, then I think that's our fault. That if
that's
the industry gets benchmarked because of that and then everyone plays into
so
that, I think it's our
what
fault.
What Sameer is
you
saying
You play the top
correct.
Six, you pay the top six, obviously.
Absolutely what Sameer is saying, that particular actor who's charging you that money is getting that. So you are feeling, okay, great, I'm recovering that cost. But everybody is basically saying, abhi aapne usko usna diya, to abhi mera itna ho gaya, ipska isko itna. And the management comes in. Because they find out first. Everybody's talking, arey, did you know Dharma's paid this much? Or did you know Yashraj has paid this much? Or did you know, but for what? It's a huge film. The budget of that film is huge. It's nothing compared to what the budget is, what everything is. But
what,
no, everything
what
then
also
then
is
starts.
Come in the wash now is that a lot of these pricing, you know, what you said, that structure that comes, that so much theatrical, so much satellite, so much digital, this is fixed and therefore this is going to do that.
Yeah.
As time passes, the streamer data is going to, you know, call out these kind of things because they are going to have a different view on how many people watch, how
the
it's...
The moment, and I shouldn't be, you know, saying this myself, but the moment there is an adjustment in, already there's an adjustment in satellite monies, massive adjustment,
right.
Because of the digital, you know, revolution. The moment there's a massive adjustment there, everything will change.
Yeah.
Everything is like...
Yeah, I mean, I think it's age old demand supply, you know, like for the number of films we make, like they're saying, there's just 7 or 8 viable stars. So,
that's it.
Yeah.
But the fact that salaries would go up during a pandemic when...
Oh, it's all gone up. Everyone's higher.
Every
single person is charging more than they did 2 years ago. Every single person. And not 10% rise, it's 100% rise sometimes.
But that's also been fueled because of the digital
also
component.
What happens is, Sameer, I can turn around and
because
say,
100 is a lucky number.
My film is the number. Everybody's claiming their film is number one on digital. There's no
correct,
way. Because
correct.
The platforms don't give out data.
Correct.
So I can sit in my house and say anything. You know, and I can put out a lovely Instagram creative and people will buy it. But the actor who knows that this is being done for perception or PR is believing that PR and perception and therefore increasing his or her price.
No, but
I'm like, we are putting it out because we also know we are
but
lying.
It is
you know we are lying.
Helping him
yet you're
believing it. It's helping him believe it. Na. He's taking that to the next person and saying,
and then there's of course the gloriousness of paid PR.
Yes.
Everybody is the mega star. I can write anything. I can write me, the beautiful, handsome new Tom Cruise on the block. I can write that. It'll be printed tomorrow. I promise you. Gorgeous at 50, just like Tom Cruise, me walking. I mean, I can write anything. You just pay and you do. Everything is a media net. As is, besides a few people, I think you one of them, we can't pay. But otherwise, everything
you
is
look
paid.
Disappointed.
It would help, you know, Anu, those stars, now you stop. But we need those stars.
No, that gold disc.
Those, anyway, those, that charts with the stars are ready before the film only. 4-4-4, 3-3-3.5.
That's
tragic. You know that 80%
so
people, those stars.
Paid pandemic cell.
There are paparazzi you pay, there are houses you pay. You do it because you have to build perception. You do whatever it takes. You do
and
it, it's all fine.
And the actors who basically start in the beginning saying, we don't give a shit about the reviews, are asking you, are you stars ka kitna aa gaya? Are but why you don't get?
Yeah.
Why have you, they are ready. They've got the pre-creative ready.
More power to all those media houses that have not succumbed to this, because it's kept the purity intact. More power, I say more power. But we are in the game now. So actors are doing it. Paps are writing anything, stepping out megastar, huge star, thunderous success, any word can be used for anything. It doesn't matter because people are writing. Any word, I'll only coin these words and give it anybody.
But my point is, why will they not do it? Because we have to, it's gone up 100%, we have to recover from somewhere.
Yeah.
So we are
it's
also looking
from
the
point. Yeah,
it's all a vicious cycle. Yeah. It's just going round and round.
And this pandemic has actually exponentially expanded this nonsense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This nonsense has gone more mad.
But
this PR nonsense.
But it will get corrected now.
You think?
Yeah.
By who?
By the digital, platforms themselves. No, it start out with the platforms, no? If they don't give, if those numbers
the
don't
the streaming
add up,
platforms.
Yeah.
Yeah.
By who?
It will.
Speaking of streaming, so OMAX said that in 2020, apparently 20 million people in India tried the web long form format for the first time. So all of you are now making streaming shows, right? Now, a couple of weeks ago, my colleague Mohini Chaudhary did a very in-depth look at this landscape, the streaming landscape, especially post-Tandav. And what she found was very, really dispiriting, you know, that so many writers, of course speaking without giving names because you can't give names anymore, talked about how afraid platforms are, how afraid makers are, and just saying that everyone just wants to make safe subjects now. You can't actually talk about anything that in any way can be problematic. And apparently, if it's set in the South, it's easier to get it through. But if there's anything in the Hindi belt, it's a no-go. How are all of you dealing with this? Because at one time, OTT was the great sort of brave new world where all of us could watch anything, do anything, have stories that have never been told before. What happens now?
I think you get more subversive, your art gets better, let's just put it that way, on a level. And I think people need to understand that it's not just filmmakers that are being censored. You are being censored. You're an audience and you're being told what you can and cannot watch.
Yeah.
So it's everybody. It's not just directors or producers, you know, or platforms. The audience needs to know that even they are being told that you're not mature enough to see this or, you know, formed enough mentally to make your own assessment. So it's everybody, and this too shall pass, I think.
Also, it's also, you must understand that all of us actively, and I'm sure when I talk about all of us, we have an active legal department now that never existed.
Yeah.
5 years ago, we never had a legal department. We have a bona fide legal department. All we're doing is fighting FIRs.
Mm.
Now, what really does is that while you can have anyone file an FIR, when the media gives so much time and space to that particular FIR filed against you, then you're combating that and your energies are being spent doing just that. And you know, there are certain news channels that something has been, some Purani Dushmani with Bollywood is coming out. I don't know what it is.
Yeah.
You know what it is? Where is it come out from? Why are they calling us like we are some Patani, we're like some enemies of this land, that I, this community, this, you know,
the
controlling body. This. What are we doing? We're only wanting to entertain people and doing it in the best possible way. I mean, like literally, I was talking to you now. 7 people come to my house, they call it a Bollywood COVID bash. We're 7 people on a terrace. How is there a COVID? And there are lead channels still reporting this. And I thought we fought this.
But you know what? In this, that this thing, this, you know, what we call now the current climate and censorship and all of that, it's always been there, right? So obviously at this point in time, we are seeing a version of it. It's not to say it wasn't there in the 80s, it was there in the 70s. You know, I just saw a photograph, really nice photograph of the entire industry with Mrs. Gandhi in 1975. A couple of months later, she announced emergency, right? So I was curious, I was trying to do some research as to what did the great liberal minds of that time have to say about the emergency. Like what was the sort of vibe, what was the people talking and doing and everything was buzzing. I couldn't find very much. Like what did everyone have to say about it? 2 years later it was called off, elections were held, life moved on. Through the 80s this has happened, you know. So there's been time and place for everything. We are going through a certain time and place, but as she said, that art is required to be subversive.
Yeah.
Art is, you know, art comes out at that time. So you've got to find ways to say things when you're told not to say them.
Yeah.
And that's what great art is in any case, in any country, in any culture.
Hopefully
that's
what
happens.
That's what we'll
and see. I think that is what is happening. We're just getting smarter at doing it. you know, I think we're finding different ways to say the same thing.
Yeah.
You know, we are doing, and sometimes we get really scared, as you say, the legal department is the most important.
Yes.
So I think Ormax has been trumped by the legal department.
Streaming platforms, you are today on a global stage. Your work is next to Fauda, which is next to Marvelous Miss Maisel, which is next to, you're on a global stage. You're not catering only to your mass now. And you have to speak a language. You have to be authentic. You have to be honest. Your work can't be dishonest. So those things are definitely going to get affected. You know, you have to understand that you are putting your filmmakers need to have the room and space to be authentic to their story, to where they come from, to their reality. And only then will it be able to resonate globally. Today you are on a world stage.
Yeah.
You can't be bullshitting.
Yeah.
That's where it's going to affect you.
Yeah.
Also, I think Anudhi, is that like Karan said about the research. So we get the research, we'll do the research. I mean, and we'll get all the numbers, we'll look at it. But even that final call possibly still has to be taken by Karan, or still has to be taken by Samir, or has to be, as a producer, you have to take, okay, I'm going to take a chance. So even in this, the legal department will possibly tell you. And lots of time, what happens is that from the person that you are making it for, will turn around and say, it's producer's prerogative.
Oh.
Right? And we turn around and say, okay, we'll take this because it's very important. It's important for the storyline. We'll figure it out. This is so important for this. Okay. So, you know, so you have to take that. We have to take, we've been taking chances for time immemorial. You're going to get this much money, thoda pun lena padega because, so we've been doing that. We have, now it's a little more informed, right? Because you have the Ormax and you have the UI and you have, a little more informed, and of course, it's becoming a little more scientific, the numbers. But the legal department now is, we have a legal department, the platform has a legal department, the actor might have a legal department. No, actors turn around and say that, nahi bolega, I'm not going to say this.
Really?
Yeah. Actors turn around sometimes and say, no, I'm not going to say this.
Because their legal has told them not to.
Yeah. Because no, all they have heard something, some other actors.
It's not just legal.
Yeah.
You'd be surprised, like when I'm directing a film, it's called Rocky or Rani Ki Prem Kahani. It doesn't sound like it could offend anyone. But when I actually gave a narration to my legal department, suddenly the script came back with many pink, like, you know, those stickers on pages. Those, and I was like, what's going on here? They said, you can't say this. I need this NOC. There were 55 points. I had to drop 20, 30. I needed NOCs from. Just anything you mention, any line is just told to you. And I'm like, that, and none of this is to do with, the film is not political, it's nothing, it's just to do with just pop culture referencing. Because everyone can sue you for anything, apparently. Yeah. You know, even you can't reference pop culture. You know,
I want to sue someone for their stupidity. You are hurting my intellectual sentiment. And I'm suing you for your stupidity.
I would love to, and I have many names on my list right now.
FIR for it. Yeah.
Okay, explain to me the obsession with remakes. Okay, every week there is either a show or a film. And it's really doubled my work because I have to go watch the original and then come to the new version. Is this just smart business because, you know, there's already source material, or is it creative bankruptcy? Where, because we seem obsessed. I think right now there are about 20 remakes happening at least.
Yeah, because I'm usually the prime suspect in these matters. So first of all, we don't call them remakes.
Huh.
We call them adaptations.
Okay.
Two is that you don't have to go and see the original to then compare it, because that's not what the larger audience does in any case. Three is that the reason you're doing it is because it's a story that travels, you believe. You know, that's a universal story and can be retold. And again, it's nothing new. You know, it's been done forever. Martin Scorsese got his first Oscar award for a remake of a Hong Kong film. You know, Departed.
Right,
so it's being done. Amir is making Forrest Gump.
Yeah.
So there's no obsession, it's just a thing, it's retelling of a story and rebooting it. No, they've made Batman 6 times, the Americans themselves.
Yeah.
So this is quite commonplace in the series business, extremely commonplace. Kaun Banega Crorepati is an adaptation of Who Wants to Be a Millionaire.
Yeah.
You know, so I mean, there's nothing new to it. Big Brother is Big Boss. So I mean, the reason we do it is because it's a good story and you think you can retell it in your land, in your culture, in your language. It's not actually made to be compared. It's not to say that now let's compare it frame to frame and see whether this is better or worse. Mm. It's a story in itself, and that's how the audience sees it, because most of the time the audience hasn't seen these.
Yeah,
right?
Sure.
Your larger audience.
Yeah, yeah.
And of course it's good business, because you know it's a proven story, it's been done, it's speed to market, you can do it quicker, you can cast it differently, you can change a lot of things around it. And in the old days, they used to just rip it off.
Yes.
Right? So at least
yes.
now people are paying money and paying license
doing
fees
right
and doing
way.
It legitimately,
yeah.
which
yeah.
is what should
well,
be done.
Well said.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
otherwise, you know.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I don't think there's so much to it, and larger audiences don't see it that way.
Yeah.
It's a, you know, it's a collection of a smaller group of people who critique it, who've seen the original and who look at it in that light.
Hmm.
But from a, I mean, we've made so many South movies into Hindi.
Of course.
Right? There was
of
a time
course.
When that was the entire industry operated on that basis.
Yeah, and the 80s.
And all big
yeah.
hits. And
yeah.
like, I don't know what the original of Himmatwala was. I never, I've just seen Himmatwala and that was good to go. Right?
It was the 80s. 80s is where it all began.
Everything. Yeah.
I've seen all.
Speaking of South, what is this pan-India film? Karan, Liger is being marketed as a pan-India film. What is a pan-India film?
So I think this whole terminology started with Bahubali.
Right.
So I essentially feel like the when we call crossover cinema, invariably when you cross, it's all over, really, because you know nothing really happens. But the real crossover cinema has to be in the country itself.
Right.
We have incredible talent in the South.
Yeah.
And Bahubali showed that it could open doors across the country. I mean, look at the way that film, the
yeah.
first film did.
In Rajasthan,
the first film
Punjab, yeah.
did, it did 112 crores, unheard of cast. Nobody knew anything. His previously released film had done 1 crore when it was made as Makki.
Yeah.
And that's why he was, you know, he had so many like trepidations about like, it just opened that. So Pan India became like, let's not call it Hindi cinema, Marathi cinema, Bengali cinema. Let's say Indian cinema, but that only happens when it's a massive event film, because you know you're getting bang for buck when you see the visual. So this Pan India thing, now it's not going to work all the time. So let's not believe that every mega star in the South and every mega director is going to be able to travel across the country. Bahubali just had that scale. It was the first, it had that massive, it almost had that Amar Chitra Katha quality, you know
yeah.
that storytelling and that mythical
mm.
value. Similarly, I believe RRR is going to be opening massively.
Mm.
If you read just the Ormax tracking number, it's close to 30 crores for day one Hindi.
Wow.
Hindi, just Hindi. Now that's huge. That is Pan India. That's Pan India screaming right at you.
Mm.
They don't know Junior NTR in Hindi. They don't know Ram Charan. They have gods and demigods in Telugu. But they're not known here. Who do we know? We know Rajamouli. We know it as a brand. But still, 30 crores. That's a huge Hindi number. I don't even want to know what this Telugu number will be like. Massive. It could very well be a day one of over 100 crores.
Right.
Much more. And
right.
worldwide even larger. Pan India is when certain elements fall into place brilliantly and beautifully. But it's not, and I repeat, going to happen with every film. You know, we can say 5 languages, but I can dub my film in any language. I can dub it in Italian and Spanish also and add that to the list. Not that I'm going to work in Italy or Spain. You know, I can keep adding languages and saying that it's... But Pan India is definitely a phenomenon. We cannot diminish it or dilute it. It exists.
Hmm.
The proof is lying in the pudding. Look at this tracking number. I mean, if you see, it's tracking higher than any other Hindi film in the climate right now. It's crazy. It's just crazy.
It's
like,
cool.
you know, I
Amazing,
remember
yeah.
Prabhas... Film One had released. My office has seen a lot of movie stars walk in and out for narrations, readings, etc. There was pandemonium in my building, in my office. People from the outside, inside, there were like 500 people in the lobby because Prabhas had come for PR, you know, for press, for Bahubali. And that's when I just said, oh my God, that means the real impact is also coming from satellite. So what is happening is, a lot of the South films that are dubbed in Hindi, many of them are actually doing very well
yeah.
on satellite.
Yeah.
So I'll give you a small tiny example. Allu Arjun is known, he's a huge megastar in the South. His last film was one of the biggest Telugu hits, Alai Vaikunte.
Yeah.
Pushpa releases right now, you saw it. It in Hindi, pure Hindi, it opened to 3 crores. You would say it's not a big number. But there are a lot of Hindi films that have been open to that number in this pandemic.
Yeah, yeah.
But Allu Arjun, in a film called Pushpa, not marketed, just cold release with a poster and digital information, People have gone to see it because they know Allu Arjun from his Telugu dubbed films into Hindi. So there is this satellite that is actually transferring some stardom, even percolating it in the north markets from the south. That's what Pan India is.
And it's been built out, this satellite market over the last 20 years.
Yeah.
Like I remember in Star, the number one rating movie used to be something called Indra the Tiger. So any week where you have a little bit,
right after Tarzan the Wonder Car.
I thought it was Tarzan the Wonder Car.
No, and Indra the Tiger. And Indra the Tiger was a big one. Then of course Suryavansh. Right. So when in doubt, play one of these three, and you get a little spike and move on. So, but Indra the Tiger is an outrageous picture. Have you ever seen it? It's very good.
But it's a gap in my
But Allu Arjun's films, his action films, are massive, massive satellite successes in Hindi. The dub in Hindi.
That's
in
so
Hindi.
Fascinating.
And it's all happening.
Yeah.
So that's why this. But I think that the South have understood scale, abandon, and complete, like whatever they do, the good ones. There's stuff that is made down South that is just incredible. Yeah. If you look for nuance, you have Malayalam cinema.
Yeah.
If you want scale and massiveness, it's Telugu. Content also Tamil. I mean, it's like there's some beautiful films. If you see The Great Indian Kitchen or Nayatu or anything made in Malayalam in the last, fantastic movies. Yeah. Down to even the stars there, such good actors. We talk about, Fahad Fazil and you talk about Dulkar Salman and such good actors, such incredible actors. I hope and pray that we can use this pan-Indianness and actually engulf talent from everywhere.
I knew nothing about The Great Indian Kitchen when I saw it. I had no idea.
It was amazing.
And it just blew my mind. And I it didn't leave me. The film didn't leave me. Like it's
so good.
Very
She's
good.
So
I mean,
good.
I stood up
very,
on my bed
good.
In the night and I clapped in the end.
Very, very
like it was just that moment. And
it
I had that similar moment
you.
When I saw Udaan. I remember
you
these are the two times I stood up and clapped.
This gets you,
on my own.
Zoya and Rima, you have described Tiger Baby Films as a hybrid of mainstream and indie. One of your most exciting projects for me is Jile Zara. And frontline by three massive female stars, Katrina, Priyanka, Alia. Tell me why it's taken us so long to get to a place where you can have a film like this, like a big budget movie with three big women acting in it. And how are the economics making sense now? Like, what has come through? What has changed?
Honestly, I think the only reason where you can do it now is that all the players involved want to do it. Hmm. I mean, even if 10 years ago, there were three big female stars, filmmakers, producers that would say, let's do this, it could have happened. I mean, finally, I think
so
everyone's
that's what's
I think it's alignment.
I think it's intent.
I think it's intent, firstly. Right. And they are huge, three of them. They are amazing and they are massive. And they are. What's beautiful about them is they're very distinct personalities. There's nobody that's like the other. I think that we have, as XL Entertainment with Dil Chahta and us with Zindagi, we have kind of made a. There is a world that's been created with those journey films.
Yes. It's definitely a universe.
Yeah, yeah. It's its own. And it. It just, and Farhan had, it was serendipity. Farhan had an idea which he had bounced and said, I want to do this with girls. He had come up with it and wanted to do this and he had told me a one line. And very independently, I was contacted by the actresses, not knowing about Farhan.
Really?
Saying that, we want to work together because Priyanka had called them. And Priyanka,
so Priyanka called
yes,
Katrina
Priyanka,
and Alia.
Yes. So it just aligned. And I think if this had happened 10 years ago, it would have happened. If these were the same players. So I
so
think
raising money on this was not
No,
a,
I think it's
an
intent.
Issue.
I really think it's intent. Like what he was saying, if you're convinced about doing something, you're going to do it. And
yeah, the only other three top stars that have done a film together in my memory is a film called Ashanti. Just for trivia. It had Parveen, Zeenat and Shabana.
Yeah.
I think just to reference, not that this is anywhere going to be like Ashanti, but there is such a film that exists with three
so
massive
exciting.
Female
movies. Yeah. So it's exciting that they've sort of themselves propelled it.
Yeah.
That's
so I think, it's intent all around.
Yeah.
You know, it happened like it was again.
I can't wait to see
be.
That film and it hasn't even started.
I know,
I'm just
me
so excited either. About it.
Me too.
It's just that cast is so exciting.
Exactly, exactly. You know, Karan, every roundtable we've done, we've talked about Brahmastra.
Yes.
Okay. finally.
It's like the Loch Ness Monster. You don't know whether it exists or not. Or it'll jump at you one day when it's not like, when it's coming out from somewhere.
We have a motion poster now.
Yes.
We have a release date.
Yes.
And, but tell me, I'm sure, Karan, that this film has tested you in ways that you didn't think possible. It's such a leap of faith for you. Tell me, what are the lessons you've learned already?
There's no lesson to learn, Anu. There are just, you'll learn, whatever you learn will be a wrong learning. You can't learn. You can just ride on the fact that there's a boy who's worked for 7 years, every day of his life, and literally I've seen it with my own eyes, blood, sweat and tears, every single day that boy has relentlessly just worked on this movie, discovered so much. I've just seen his passion. And he has had actors that have given him everything. Literally, I met Rajamouli sir, and he used to say how Prabhas and Rana Raghupati gave 5 years of their life to Bahubali. Ranbir has given 7 years. Alia has given 7 years. Without questioning, dates have got adjusted, schedules have moved, governments have changed. Brahmastra was still on. It was still on, and there was that kid who has grown up. Alia grew up with Brahmastra when she signed the film. She was 21 years old. I mean, she's 28 today. And you know, the film is going to release, she'll be 29 when the film releases. She's literally grown up in cinema. She came as a newbie to a veteran actress now, and that film is still, and it was not because it was being delayed for any indulgent reason or something, that it was just taking so long to match execution to vision. And I know that I don't regret a single day of giving my support and love, or the studio, Disney, that have put in all their muscle as well, or the members of the cast, if you ask them. Even now, when I see his ADs, they're so passionate about each and every frame of Brahmastra. That just comes from the top, it just comes from my hand. Yeah. So I mean, like, I just know, I don't know the end result, none of us do. We just hope and pray, literally every day, that it matches. And none of us are in it for the money anymore. Because the Lord knows that even if the film is a mega blockbuster, it's not that everyone is taking a fat check home, because all the money is in the film. But it's become like a passion project beyond passion. And now we just have to, like, so you're saying, what lesson have I learned? Yes, I've learned a lot of VFX lessons. You know, I've realized that those, that it takes time, that you make a film, you've got to give it time. You know, you've learned the power of storyboarding. You've learned the power of also working with people who really care about your film. And they didn't just sign up for, like, they don't just sign your film because it's money to them, or it's a commitment, or it's just, it's because they really believe in. If you're doing something that large, you've got to have a crew that actually becomes organically embedded in that film's fabric. And that's what happened with Brahmastra. Like, Nagarjuna, he came on board. Shah Rukh has done a massive cameo for us. We thought it would be 5 days, he shot 15. And without a question asked, you know, he saw the vision of the sequence. Naag sir, and it's like Mr. Bachchan, like, it became just about, like, this is not just, it's our film, it's everyone's film. You can stake ownership on it. Tomorrow, the producer list is large, the actor list is larger. It's like we're all just like part of this one big mega film that just needs the world to watch it. So we, like, literally want every center in this country and world to come out and watch Brahmastra, because we really need, we don't need it just for the money, we need it to kind of validate those 7 years.
Yeah, absolutely. Nikhil, MA Entertainment, 10 years this year. It's very intriguing to me how you put out such a diverse sort of variety of content, right? You're making films and shows, and, like, I think you had 2 weeks or 1 week where you had two shows dropping on different platforms in the same week. What's amazing to me, it's so diverse that I can't actually figure you out as a filmmaker, what your voice is, right? Because you make the superb Mumbai Diaries, and then you make Satyamai Vijayate too, which for me was quite unwatchable. Why do you have to do both of these?
Well, the thing is that it's a little left brain, right brain kind of scenario as far as we are concerned at MA Entertainment. Yeah. So, as far as Satyamev Jayate is concerned, Milap was somebody who we are very close to. He wanted to make it. So there's a vertical that works on that kind of cinema. And very clearly, I basically give as much support as I can give to that. Where it comes to Mumbai Diaries, or where it comes to Rocket Boys, where it comes to the other shows that we are doing, or the other films that we are doing, it's I'm fully in the sense my, so even the thing with Milab is literally that you can't argue with him. I can't argue with him. He tells me, this is not for your audience, this is not for your audience. So I accept it. It's not for my audience. And I move on from that. So, but there are certain things that the decisions that we have to take as a young company, and we have to do those kind of things. The first one worked very well for us. Nobody had any kind of expectation from it. It worked very well for us. It made sense to do the second one. Everybody got in, everybody did it. Whether I was in, how much I was involved, not involved, is a different conversation. But that's what we are right now. But like Karan said, we as a company, we are growing, we are assessing, we are looking at our mistakes. We are saying, okay, today now we are in the 10th year, we cannot be making so many mistakes. People are looking at us. The people are now able to recognize what MA Entertainment is making, right? So when it comes to that voice, I think more and more you will start seeing what that voice is, and what the stuff that we are putting out, more and more will start talking about that voice.
And Samir, you've set up Applause, you said in an interview, as an old-fashioned movie studio.
Completely.
Right?
I'm going to emulate them.
you want to be Dharma? Now, you're doing everything. You're doing shows, films, but also animation, also documentaries. You said what you do is you work like alchemists.
Right.
What does that mean?
Well, what it means is exactly what the term means, is that the way we've set up the company is to work with a variety of creative talent, with a variety of producers, production houses. We actually don't produce ourselves. We work with partners. And we set out by doing series first, because we had to grow up to movies. Now we've made a few baby steps, so we started making a few small movies. We have bigger ambition. We're doing some animation, because I think content is important, documentaries. So the sense really for us is that, I think there's a huge, the appetite for great content is only going to increase. And when I say we are like a traditional film studio, is that what we are doing and actively doing from the start, and we've done it in the series business, is that we raise capital for making finished product, which we then license out. Mm-hmm. So we have been trying very hard to not get commissioned, and work in the old TV model in India. Yeah. In the US it was different, obviously. So that's what we are doing. And I think we're having the time of our life.
Thank God. Guys, I'm almost done, but I have two more questions. So yeah, you talked about the fact that it's offensive to you that the crew is being paid so much less than the actors, right? So I was talking to Deepika last week, and she was talking about how we really need to look at better working conditions for crew, better food for crew. There was that accident on the set of Rust in New Mexico US, yeah, where Alec Baldwin accidentally shot and killed the DOP. And we did an interview with Priya Seth, the DOP here, and she said that routinely lives are risked on our sets. Mm-hmm. It's not even like a thing that we all think about. It's just done. How do we speak to this a little bit? How do we address these things? Because this is real. This is every day. What do we do?
People have to care. People have to care. The producers have to get together.
But where are you saying producers don't care?
Beyond a point, no. Most of them don't. They don't have safety measures. There are sets I know now, they still don't have fire extinguishers on set. These are basics. They don't care. I don't know how old the tarafas are in certain studios. You have people walking. They're there for 12 hours. You can't do that anywhere in the world. And they're not harnessed, so people don't care. I'm sorry, this is happening all the time. So people have to care. They have to realize you don't have to wait for something to happen to then get into gear. We have to get into gear now.
Yeah.
This is the industry. You have to take care of it. And that's, yes, when the pandemic happened, the producers all got together.
Yes.
They all vaccinated everybody. So there is that side. It is available. There is that thing where you feel it's ours and, it's our crew and our people. But this needs to extend to everyday working conditions, because once you're pressured, you forget. And you can't forget, The wages, and it's not even like the above the line, you need to slash that. You just need a little bit of a balance. You need to balance it. It's vulgar.
Yeah.
It's absolutely vulgar.
Karan, you've started a foundation.
Yeah.
Is that with this view to kind of address the inequity?
It's basically for the industry. It's something that I know my father really wanted to do, which is why I named it after him. I come from a school where my father cared.
Yeah.
He
really did.
He cared.
Yeah.
He used to say that it doesn't matter if your film is a flop or a hit, but if your crew is unhappy, it's already a disaster.
Yeah.
you know. So, I mean, he cared. I mean, innumerable stories, Nikki will tell you, you know, Zoya has heard from her dad. Like, just like literally, like, strangely, I mean, just the other day, and I was, it was one of the reasons why I even started the foundation, was like, Vicky's dad, you know, told me, Shyamji, about how he got injured on the sets of Agnipath, the original Agnipath. And he says, the next thing I knew is that your father had caught hold of him and taken him to a hospital, stayed there till he was okay, flew him back to Bombay. That was who he was, you know, and I don't think I can measure up. It's just tough to measure up to a man like that. But the ethos is there, you know, the feeling is there, the need to kind of make sure that we do something. When Zoe and I came together, you know, even to do Eye for India at that time, it was like, because we care. You know, our companies care. You need to care. Like, she, that's what she said. To sum it up, is really, you need to care.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I think it's not only about producers. I think it needs to be more institutional. Mm. In the sense, the guild, the yeah. unions, yeah. the everybody has to come together, because we can, we'll do it. The problem is, you know, during this pandemic, so many of the, or so many actors have, old actors called up and said, we don't have the money for the, for hospitals, we don't have money for medical, we don't have, associate directors, I mean, you know, we have, I worked with people who during, when in Nayanukkad or had worked in Yash Raj, people who have just, they have now, they don't, they their savings are over. Yeah. So residual, this whole concept of residual, insurance, we don't, how come we are, I mean, we insure the film. You have to, everybody needs to be insured outside the film also. The, I think the unions, so the unions are only here if, like, for instance, somebody basically says, ki, you know, I gave a script. And they have some kind of dispute. No, it needs to be about, and the children. I mean, we have rules for animal, this thing, AWBI, and you how you're shooting with animals.
It's true.
We don't have rules for children.
Yeah.
It's true, it's scary.
Yeah.
I've gone onto sets for these dance shows and all for children, and they've been sitting for 20 hours in some, this thing, no toilets, nothing, eating out of plates which are not being washed. It's just unbelievable. It's unbelievable. We have to, as, and we can produce, we constantly tell the guild, do something about it, do something about it. But there are 20 other unions yeah. that we have to deal with.
Yeah.
And actually, this is, you know, what this is one is about caring, and the two is that it's quite easily done.
Yeah.
In all other industries, you know, the industry effort, as they call it, is much better organized.
Right.
You know, as in all the different stakeholders work better together, they lobby together, they, you know, they create a industry norm. This industry, you know, unfortunately, has always been very, you know, sort of unique, scattered, you know, very independent-minded. But it can be done. I mean, if you look at all the players,
you get targeted
from the theaters to the
satellite
to the streamers
and all, people
and all the producers and everyone in it. There's a lot of money.
I know.
You know, and a fraction of that money can take care of, you know, insurances.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know,
it's a
all
percentage.
Of that. Safety is just
it's a percentage.
So who leads this? Who should be the person?
I think the guild has been quite active. I have to say, with Sid Roy Kapoor, who's been an excellent president, I think, you know.
He's amazing.
Nitin, and I think he's been quite a trooper, and I hope he just keeps going and doesn't run away from the post, because it is also a lot of responsibility. But he's been fantastic and very proactive. One call and things are done. And so I know for a fact that alignment and infrastructure is all there. Intent has to come.
Yeah.
But the guild again is only 150 of us.
Yeah.
Or so what, 120, 150?
There are all the other unions, the
so-called
to align.
Top producers. Are, but what the other? You have to make it a rule. Like, for instance, now when we work with platforms, Anu, they eco, e-green, COVID.
Yeah.
It's
even sexual harassment.
Literally,
it's
my EP will come
you know,
to me
so
and say that listen, they shut down somebody right now in Punjab.
Hmm.
So they will shut you down. You cannot have. You have to make sure, so if it's going to take time to get the crew in, because everybody has to be temperature checked, we have to do it.
Right.
Work it out in your schedule.
Right.
Yeah.
So you have to follow the process. Certain things in your budget, you work it out.
Yeah.
But
yeah, we've accounted for
it
already.
Yeah. They're basics.
Yeah.
Okay, last question. Arundhati Roy said that pandemics work like portals. They're basically gateways to from one world to another. What do you think the next world will be like for the Hindi film industry? What is the biggest change that you see coming? Reema, we haven't heard from you in a long time. You go first.
Well, I think that, you know, in some time this pandemic is going to die.
Yeah.
And theaters will, I mean, hoping maybe, I don't know if I think this, I'm hoping this, that theaters will open and everything will go back to normal. Mm. But In terms of, you know, like we were speaking earlier, I think certain kinds of films will find it more difficult to have a theatrical release, and that's because of the OTTs coming into play. But I don't think that's necessarily a bad thing, because everybody gets to make what they want. Yeah. And to me, as a filmmaker, I don't care if I'm releasing in a theater or it's coming out on an OTT platform, because I'm getting to tell the story I want to tell and engage.
So we have to change our view of this.
Yeah.
But you see because this becoming a change.
We were one of the very first few people who jumped onto the OTT bandwagon, so to speak. But again, I never looked at it as a come down.
Yeah.
It's something I do. I watch content all the time. And so for me, it was never a come down.
Yeah. And it isn't. What you made for OTT is just gorgeous. When is season 2 dropping?
When we finish this pandemic. And Made in Heaven and the pandemic are going neck to neck.
Yeah. Once we stop getting locked down.
The minute we can finish it and stop getting locked down, yes, it'll be out.
Okay, Zoya, what is the biggest change you see coming?
You know, I the fact that you said portal is interesting, because, and what he said about Pan India and crossover, I think what has happened in the pandemic is everyone's watching content on streamers, and they're watching multilingual content. So people, and I feel that there's been a serious exchange there, and weirdly, the cinematic world has gotten smaller. So I see a lot of amazing tie-ups, there's awareness of other industries, there's awareness of other artists, and I feel that cross-pollination is going to happen a lot more. I do believe cinema is going to come back. Nothing is going to kill the big screen. Nothing is going to change that experience. It's coming back, and I'm really waiting for it in its full glory. But what I think has happened is that even the digital world is a portal, and I think that's opened many doors, and we're going to be all over the world. We're going to be everywhere. That's exciting.
Yeah, that's very exciting.
That's what I think.
Yeah. Nikhil?
I think finally a lot of the actors that had resigned themselves to be the hero's best friend or brother or whatever are going to see a huge resurgence. I mean, you're going to see a huge recognition. Like, I mean, I'm so happy for Manoj Bajpayee.
Yeah.
I wish Irfan today was alive. He would have been ruling the scene. We would be fighting for his dates, you know. So I really feel that whether it's Pankaj, whether it's Manoj, whether it's Samantha Root, whether it is these names are now going to become household
names. Pratik Gandhi, Jaideep Alawat, absolutely.
I mean, look at Arjun. It's superb.
He's fantastic.
He's fantastic. Oh, you don't know. Oh, he was in luck by chance.
He was in luck by chance. Friend, exactly.
You know, but he's just fantastic. You know, so as a it also liberating as a maker. You don't have to really only think about those 7-8 guys that you have to.
The 135
crore
men.
So you don't have to think about that, right? So I mean, I framed a tweet I got from Mumbai Diaries. I framed it. I put on my because it says that I will not watch your show. How could you have made Mahadev into say the F word 3 times? You know, I did not even know Mohit Raina was Mahadev.
Blasphemy.
How is it in LA?
How is that even possible?
I don't know Mohit Raina.
That's my question to everyone. How have things been in LA?
It was fantastic.
He was Har Har Mahadev, and he was a household name for
everyone. Exactly.
Yes. I had no idea.
Because things have been tough in LA.
So really now, you know, I'm so happy for Mohit. I'm so happy for
him. He's fantastic.
These actors, you know, I mean, Manoj is also should now understand not to increase his price tag by 100.
Shout out to Manoj. Sameer, for you.
Actually, most of what's happening now was happening. Mm. You know, this was the trend. This was
you
the momentum.
You feel like you're not surprised by anything.
I'm not. Not really. So there was it was going to be a mass of niches. No, Jio had already happened.
Right.
We were going to get to 500 million subscribers. Internet was going to explode. Cheapest data. Also, this thing about the pandemic being a portal and we've all passed through and come into another dimension, I'm not such a big fan of that kind of thinking. I think, the minute things settle down, we're all going to revert to our own selfish ways.
Mm.
Everything Kuch gets back to normal. No, badlega, bahut badal gaya. So what has happened is that the streamers and the whole streaming business has got accelerated.
Mm.
That's happened. Mm. Our consumption of global content and all of that has increased. Not only global, even Indian content. The amount of previously all content was blocked by geography and by language.
Yeah.
Because that's how TV worked. The streamers have at least broken that. We used to call TV is your window to the world. Actually, TV was window to your state or city or language. This is now your window to the world. So, I mean, those things have happened, but they were expected. I think what will happen now, one good thing, is that all of this has got accelerated. So it's got just jump started. So the pandemic has done in a funny way. We didn't lose 300 million lives or whatever, but we did get a billion people onto this new connected world.
Yeah.
And that is going to, you know, stand us in good stead.
Yeah. And last word to you, Karan.
I think there's going to be some feng shui that's going to happen, you know. You know, in feng shui, they say clutter is not a good thing. So I think in this pandemic, what's going to happen is that a lot of the clutter will be decluttered. A lot of bahut logon ki chori pakdi jayegi. So it's like a lot that was should not exist will not exist. And a lot that should be in the forefront will come to the forefront, which is what is happening. Suddenly, everything that's great and good is right bang on in front, staring at you. You know it. And what's not good, the exact opposite is happening with that. So there'll be a lot of decluttering happening, which is all good. We needed some vacuuming. And I think that's going to happen. And I believe very strongly, and I'm not saying this because I'm just an eternal optimist or I'm trying to be poetic about the times ahead. But I believe that what we call the golden era of entertainment, we're working towards it. We're a work in progress, but we're getting there. There's going to be strong content digitally, better films being made, stronger actors, better technicians, world acknowledgement, it's all going to happen.
How lovely. Aapke muh mein ghee shakkar. On that happy note, I'm also an eternal optimist, so yeah. Definitely.
No, and I don't come from a place of hope. I come from a place of assurance. Yes, it may take its time, but it's going to happen. I'm seeing it. I'm seeing it happen. The evolution has already begun. Yeah. Yes, you will go through some obstacles to surmount to reach there, and we needed to do that. I'm not saying we needed this pandemic, but there has to be an upside to everything.
Indeed.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And I
thank
can't
you.
Wait
thank you
to see all the movies and shows you guys put out soon.
Thank you.
Hello, you're about to watch the prolific Producers Roundtable. We say that because we're a very humble lot of people who are in front of you. We had a great conversation with Anu. She had some very grim situations, slightly distressing situations about the entertainment industry, but we really lifted her spirits and we hope we lift yours too. If you love this video, please subscribe to Film Companion.